And we're at the Neubauer Family Farms break before closing here at the Bell Tower Championship presented by Charleston School of Law. And Jonathan Woodward here with Josh LaCrone. And if there was a headline for the defense case in chief, I think it would have to be the impeachments of the Yale witnesses.
Yeah, high risk, high reward direct testimonies there. Two witnesses were impeached, a third could have been impeached.
Absolutely.
Starting out with Mr. Fisher, again, a high-risk character portrayal here. We weren't exactly sure what his issue was. He seemed to be not all there, and that may have played into their case theory, that he maybe didn't perhaps see what he thought he saw. You know, one of the things, though, that I have to point out, and this is something I point out to my own students all the time, Daniel Stern did a very effective job during that direct examination arguing objections. He's arguing his case. He's
right.
Arguing his case to the jury, pointing out substantive facts that move the ball for the defense on those objection arguments. But it all comes down to that impeachment, you know, and the same thing with the impeachment of the second witness. There are a lot of AMTA alums on this final panel. Will they score those witnesses down?
Yeah, and I'm not sure. That particular impeachment wasn't quite as material as the one that we saw with Taylor Strombaum. But just sticking with Sam Fisher for a moment again, that was portrayed by Patrick Doolittle from Yale University. Daniel Stern there again doing the direct. Alexandra Piacenti from Virginia doing the cross. Hard to pin down exactly what type of witness character that was, a little bit reminiscent of some of the Ian Lampert characters we might have seen from previous years from UCLA, a little bit of a New York-type accent, just sort of a quirky demeanor. And I think that prevented the impeachment there from maybe being as effective as it could be. But when you got to Taylor Strombaum with the signature issue, that seemed like a really big invention.
It did, and I'll say I loved Strombaum. I thought the
great character.
The accent was great all the way through. All the accents have been pretty solid all evening. Funny stuff, good character, but I thought the impeachment was very, very effective. And again, we have a number. We have 15 judges with blue ballots in their hands.
Right.
A good majority of them, either having competed in American Mock Trial Association, coached, several who've won this tournament before, and I just wonder if the balance in this round will come down to how those witnesses were scored.
Got some former board members out there on the judging panel, too, one of whom is now a sitting judge in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Correct.
So obviously, you know, when you talk about invention of fact and some of the things along those lines, that could be something that could be a turning point here. Virginia very strong with the objections to the demonstratives, with the objection to sort of the role-playing of how things went through during the course of the sequence of events. But the presiding judge hasn't seemed too interested in shutting much of that down.
Yes, the presiding judge seems as if he's maybe got somewhere to be. He's moving the trial along very, very quickly. I will say kind of the big takeaway to me before we go into closing arguments is the most effective thing by both sides has been cross-examination. Excellent cross-examinations on both sides. The one thing that I will say that I thought Yale did differently with their witnesses that Virginia didn't is, you know, you come into a case with someone who's dead, a very violent murder. Virginia took the tact of, we're not going to make jokes. This isn't going to be a funny trial. This isn't going to be a traditional AMTA, you know,
right,
character witness-driven trial. Yale challenged that. They got
did.
Up there. They called funny witnesses. They called witnesses with lines, with accents that, you know, weren't subtle. And again, it comes down to which style is the jury going to like in this type of case. Yale certainly taking a lot of risks here.
Yeah. Well, before we get into closing arguments, we've got a little bit of time to talk about the defendant, Skylar Sinclair, portrayed by Allison Durkin from Yale. Sarah Cohen from Yale doing the direct there. Kate Villani from Virginia doing the cross. I thought really strong performances all around. And that was probably the most damaging cross that Virginia put together today, I thought.
Yeah, it was very interesting because I thought the defendant portrayal was excellent. she was she didn't cry, but she was angry about the position she's in. She was vehement that she did not commit this crime.
Right.
But then, you know, faced with a very, very tough cross-examination, she lost her anger. And you don't see that a lot. So oftentimes you see the witness's anger level rise under cross-examination.
Absolutely.
She didn't do that. She did the opposite. Obviously an intentional action on the part of Yale to do that. Very good direct, very good cross.
But again, keeping our focus on sort of the energy level or the demeanor, even in the crosses, Virginia did not seem to go with sort of the angry, emotional type of thing. It was very consistent with their performance throughout the rest of the trial, where you were seeing very calm, very measured type performances. There wasn't a lot of voices being raised. There weren't fingers being pointed.
That's right.
It really kept with that. I've used the word clinical several times, not to say that it's boring by any stretch of the imagination, but very much a counterpoint from what you see from someone like Mr. Stern.
Two very different styles, and that's an excellent point you make, because you saw just the hint of a potential impeachment by Mr. Stern, and he was very animated, really ready to go, and yet you saw two very effective actual impeachments, and they were so kind of subtle, calm, very mechanical impeachments, and I thought they came across very well. And it is, it's two very different styles. I think certainly that the pendulum, we saw what we thought was a little bit of momentum on Yale coming out of the prosecution's case in chief. I think the pendulum swung back a little bit in Virginia's favor with the risks taken by Yale and their strong cross-examinations.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, when I sort of look at, now that we've seen both cases in chief, we've got the evidence in, what do you think each side needs to do in closing argument to try and bring this home for their respective teams, starting with Virginia as the state?
I think that Virginia has to get up in closing argument and act like they care that someone has died. They have been so kind of quiet and so reserved. And, you know, you see through the trial, for those of you watching at home, you can see Miss Wheeler, the widow back there, she's still crying. Her mascara is still running.
Yep.
And that is great theater. But I want to see that out of the attorneys. I want to see them ask for justice. I want to see them get fired up about this crime. On the defense side, you know, I think what the attorneys have been doing has been very effective. You can quibble with their witnesses, but I think what their attorneys have been doing has been very effective. And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm excited to see the closing argument of Daniel Stern.
Do you think Virginia brings up the impeachments, the inventions, in the closing argument, or do they stay on script and really focus on their theory of following the blood and not address some of the reasons why the witnesses from Yale weren't as believable and credible?
I think they stay on script, and I'll tell you why. The facts are in their favor. They've got the bat. They've got the mask. There was really no introduction of the mask or the flip-flop or even a picture of the bat, which is a little surprising. You have all these wonderful pieces of evidence. But they still have all that DNA evidence tying the defendant to this crime. I don't think that you stray from your strategy of follow the blood. If I'm Virginia, I'm resting on the fact that my impeachments were effective and the jury believed that. And if you're watching during the round, you can see pretty much in every picture there, you can see Mr. Stern sitting on the edge of his table and Mr. Zhu right next to him. Every time that their witness got impeached, they're watching the faces of the jury. They know the impeachments
right.
are coming.
Exactly.
And they want to see the reaction of the jurors as to whether or not they're buying the impeachments or if they're angry at the witness.
We should note that from where we're sitting, we can't see the jury members. So we're not able to really read their body language or their facial expressions. We can see the presiding judge, but not any of the blue ballots in the jury box.
That's correct.
So those folks out there maybe have a little bit better idea than we do of exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah.
In terms of Daniel Stern for Yale, is there anything you think he needs to do different in closing argument from what they thought they were going to have to do coming into the round?
I don't think so. You know, I think Daniel Stern's going to do what he intended to do. I think he's going to do what he did all year. I think he's going to do what he did all last year, and that's just be the loudest voice in the room, the most logical voice in the room. The defense has a lot of reasonable doubt
to
hang their hat on.
Yeah.
They do, and I think he's going to do a very good job of pointing out the right-handed versus left-handed, the height. We didn't hear a lot about the limp, but it's still out there. I think he's going to be a tornado out there. I think he's going to use the entirety of that well. And if it's as good as it was last year, I think it's going to be very, very effective.
In terms of what to expect afterwards, when we're tabbing the ballots, do you foresee this? Obviously, we've got closing arguments left to go, so we don't have a complete ballot, but we've got 130 scores out of 140 written down on both ballots. How much of a split are you expecting at this point? And I'm going to cut off at that point, cut you off. It appears that the jury, the scoring judges, are walking back into the courtroom right now. We've got 1 quick minute. You expecting a big split here?
I'm expecting a very close round, a very close results. I think it really hinges on how the jurors, the judges here feel about what Yale did during their case in chief. After the closing arguments, I may have a more specific prediction, but we'll see. And I see our presiding judge is now taking the bench, so we'll send it back to him.
18 minutes left to go in the season. Let's hear from Ms. Villani and Mr. Stern.